Now we will be discussing about the role of corporate citizen in the business community, where we will be discussing on two things, the ethical sourcing and the fair trade practices. So, if we can understand the concept of ethical sourcing is related to the extended responsibility of the organization of the firm towards not only its suppliers, but maybe suppliers of suppliers also, and how it can use its power, political power, or the its position being more powerful in this network to in a positive way to see like the suppliers, if they really want to supply to the corporate, they are taking care of its own processes, and also they are taking due care of choosing their own suppliers also. So, through this way of ethical sourcing, so the company can, if it wants, influence the suppliers of suppliers also to follow ethical processes in doing their businesses, and thus the region in which the business is done is the practices in that region, even if maybe the regulations are not that strong, can help the to get the benefits of the good practices to be followed, which where the rights are respected and not violated, and less of harm is produced to the stakeholders. So, what is ethical sourcing? It is the inclusion of explicit social, ethical, and or environmental criteria into supply chain management practices, procedures, policies, and procedures and programs. So, it is the inclusion of, as we can see, like there is a reflection of the sustainability dimensions of the taking care of the environment and the social issues, if it want to enter into a economic relationship with the organization, with the firm. So, if it wants to look into the relationship from an economic perspective, it has to take care of the social and the environmental perspective also. So, ethical sourcing is the inclusion of this explicit social, ethical, and or environmental criteria into supply chain management policies, procedures, and programs. So, whether the suppliers are ready to comply to the standards or resist pressures to certify to like ISO 14001 and is strongly determined by that the dynamics of the relationship which they have with the companies that is purchasing from them. So, if the suppliers are more dependent on their customers, they are more likely to comply. So, if the customer, here the firm in concern, is more powerful than the suppliers, then they can influence the suppliers to comply to these demands. If they are relatively new entrants into the industry, and of course they are like trying to get a prominence or making it space in the business space. So they have to comply to this in order to get the orders and to get businesses. So these are this when they are relatively new entrants. So, and the act of the suppliers, the publicly informed, when it informs in the public domain, like the act of gaining an ethical certification, so it can use as used as a tool of reducing the information asymmetry between themselves and the potential buyers. So that may attract more potential buyers to the suppliers if they see like they have followed the ethical steps properly in dealing, in taking care, and they have been certified as companies who have been taking care of the social and the environmental issues in the way that they are doing their business or they are producing their goods or services. So if that certification is there, that is going to attract more buyers to it. So ethical sourcing, it talks of more like of a business to business regulation. So why we are talking of business to business regulation is that, like when you are talking in terms of corporate citizenship, so in many cases it is seen like when it talks of the getting some things corrected in the organization, and it is maybe people for mainly from the perspective of the pressure groups, when they see like the it's like small firms are maybe not hearing to what they are telling them to provide for the stakeholders who are involved with their businesses. So if the protest is done against the person, against the group, business house who is sourcing from these suppliers, and if a protest can be made around that MNC who is sourcing from these kind of suppliers who are not following the ethical standards of policies, practices and programs, then to answer to these protests or to like answer to the negative effects of these protests that may have on their own businesses, the MNCs may take into techniques of entering into business to business regulation. So where they take strategies where ethical sourcing becomes a strategy for business to business regulation, where one business tries to regulate what other businesses are doing, businesses which who are related to it are doing, by exerting some pressure on it, some power on it. So here we'll see like ethical sourcing can be used as a business to business regulation model also, where the pressure exerted by the powerful corporate customers to comply with ethical sourcing guidelines and criteria constitutes strong and often very effective regulation for supply chain members. So because the suppliers survive by organ business, by doing by entering into a business relationship with the MNCs or a more powerful corporate which has the ability to pay, and when based on that profit that is gained from selling the goods or services is what makes the supplier survive also. So the MNCs can exert pressure on these suppliers, these corporate customers can exert pressures on these suppliers to follow the ethical sourcing guidelines and principles and criteria, and that helps in regulating the supply chain members. And when we are talking of the supply chain members, we are talking of the suppliers as well as the supplier of suppliers or all the other stakeholders who are connected with that particular supplier. So the different strategies of business to business regulation taken are like, first is the disengagement, where it is a setting of clear standards for suppliers and a means for assessing the compliance with those standards. So we will be taking your buying from you only when you are following these standards, and if you meet this criteria. If you are not doing it, then maybe we are not going to take from you, we are not going to buy from you. Again, like failure to meet the standards, failure to meet the standards in short or medium term will result in disengagement of by the community, by the company. Means any failure, sort of like zero tolerance type of thing, like any failure to meet the standards, even in for short term or a medium term target set by the organization, will result in like you getting the suppliers getting sort of blacklisted, and the company is entering into a disengagement, will lead to disengagement by the company. Means we are no longer going to procure from you. The other way of business to business regulation could be an engagement strategy. So this is a sort of like compliance, and if the you are not complying to it, then what are the punishments that are going to follow in terms of you getting the supplier getting blacklisted and not we are not procuring from us from the supplier anymore. There could be another way of looking into this business to business regulation when you are talking of this as an engagement strategy. So this could be like hand holding support, sort of where rely on longer term aims together with incremental targets in order to foster step by step approach to improving standards. So this is a positive approach where we can interpret it like the thing, like people who don't know even what are the standards to be followed, people who may not be having that developed infrastructure to do all the things as required by the standards and criteria to be met, so may not be in a position or competent enough to meet those standards also, because the infrastructure is maybe not there, the capital is not there, the know-how is not there, could be the list of so many things which are not there. So in that case, it may require a positive hand-holding support, a development-oriented approach from the corporate, which works together in setting up some target for the supplier, helping it to achieve those targets through sharing of their know-how, providing some support for their developing of their competencies, achieving these targets, and to achieve the improvements, maybe providing them some infrastructure for it. So this is a positive way of looking into the how to develop the competencies of the suppliers so that they are able to achieve the standards. So supplier education, supplier development, these will be considered when we are talking of the engagement perspective of how we are extending our role to develop the competencies and the capabilities of the suppliers so that they become competent enough to follow the standards and criteria as expected in the standard that that should be achieved as per the global standards may be mentioned, and that's how become more like responsible about the social and the environmental issues related to the this production processes. So this talks of a hand holding support and extended role also of the extended responsibility of the corporate also. Now we'll be discussing of the from the viewpoint of the competitors, specifically looking into the indigenous competitors who do not have again the capability or the competency to or the infrastructure to compete with the major players, and in many cases that is how they are washed off from the market or they get deprived of what they are actually entitled to get. So one of the practices, one of the system that is aimed towards taking care of these issues is called the fair trade practice. So let us see what is a fair trade. Fair trade is a system which is aimed at offering the most disadvantaged producers in developing countries to move out of the poverty to creating market access under beneficial rather than exploitative terms. The objective is to empower producers to develop their own businesses and wider communities through international trade. So what it is like there, it is in the fair trade practices, it is like giving the most disadvantageous producers in the developing countries and in exposure to the through international trade, an exposure to the to a better market when where they get the price of the their products price of their products, and at least something minimum is ensured based on what the mutually agreed by the this fair parties involved in the fair trade process, a minimum, at least some minimum price is set which the which these indigenous producers get for their products. And if so, even if a minimum price which gets preset, so even if the market is not functioning that well, they are at least having the even if the market is not functioning that well, they at least are secured so that they get the basic minimum which is determined. If it is functioning well, then they get the beyond the minimum what has been decided, so they get that portion also, and that's how they get a share of the profit also. So it is a system like where the fairness is maintained by the disadvantages get the most of the benefit by if they get whichever one is higher. Like if the minimum determined price that they are going to get is higher in which the actual sale takes place, so at the price which the actual sale takes place, then also they are getting the benefit of getting the higher. And if the minimum set price is lower than what the actual price it is sold, the sell price is, then they get the higher one at which it is actually sold. So in that way there is a protection given to the indigenous producers from getting exploited. So it is a safety net cover given from getting exploited. So it fosters, like it aims at the protection and the empowerment of the growers. And so empowerment of the growers because they get exposure to the different or to the international trade through the practices, through the they get an exposure to a wider community of business, and it empowers producers to, because of this assurance of protection is there, like they will at least get something minimum, and whichever is the higher, the decided price, minimum price, or the actual price in which it is the products are sold, whichever is higher, they are entitled to it. This forms of like coverage, the protection, this gives a motivation for the people to enter into this type of businesses, enter into businesses producing things, cultivating things. So these type of empowerment actually encourages people to develop their own businesses, and this then spread across the wider community, and it encourages community development, because if somebody gets encouraged to enter into these type of activities, it creates employment opportunity for few others also who get involved with that activity, and ultimately it leads to the development of the community at large. So it encourages community development by guaranteeing minimum prices and at least some conditions, minimum fixed conditions, so that you have a safety zone of like you are not deprived of the minimum benefits. So in 2008, like it's a data which shows like the fair trade sales grew by 22%, but the concern over is that however this success could not guarantee or put pressure on the ethical standard, so it's maybe at the it could not ensure like the way that these producers are disadvantaged producers are producing the process taken by them to produce their products or was done in an ethical way or not following the ethical standards. The success of this could not guarantee that, and also with this is also a challenge. So because we saw in the last discussion that we discussed, like when MNCs come to a developing country with business opportunities, then and it creates employment opportunities for people. So they come in a sort of dilemma, like whether to continue with my own businesses, which has its own challenges and threats, or to become employed in a particular business which gives a certain security. And like so, and to like develop the skills that are required for getting new jobs in that particular MNCs, for the trying to nurture for the skills that are required by the particular MNCs, so that we can secure our jobs in future over there. So these could be processes of dilemma, conflict, and become challenging for the fair trade system also. So we have got a hint of taking concern of the environmental and the ethical issues and the social issues when we are talking of the ethical sourcing, and also when you discussed about fair trade practices, which takes care of the ensuring like economic sustainability of the indigenous producers by providing them a place of a fair practices where they can get at least a minimum promised like gain for what they have produced and sold. So this somewhere we are focusing slowly towards the concept of sustainability. Here we have looked into the sustainability of the business practices and how it takes care of the people doing the business, and the how they are concerned with the environmental, ethical and social issues with respect to the business at present, and the harms that they may be giving to each other, and the benefits that they may be sharing with each other for the people who are presently involved in the business, and the stakeholders whom we can now presently identify as our stakeholders in the present scenario. We'll extend this discussion to the sustainability and business relationship, where we're talking of towards industrial ecosystem and how these processes can get connected to each other. Each of the industrial players which are there in the ecosystem can get connected to each other. So the processes that we are taking up, the policies that we are taking up, programs that we are taking up, leads to the like survival of not only the present generation, but we look for and to take the extra extended responsibility to take care of the future generation also, and to not to provide them any harm which is maybe we have not foreseen now, to restrict ourselves from giving any unforeseen harm towards the future stakeholders, towards the future generations also, so that they have enough of resources present which they can utilize for meeting their own demands and needs. So it is when you are bringing sustainability concept into this business relationship, how do we preserve certain resources, do less of wastages, so that in the process of doing your business by following certain policies and programs, so that the right of the future generation is also taken care of and they are also not deprived of their resources, or they are not deprived of proper environment, which could be detrimental to their survival and well-being. This concept we'll take up in the next module when we are discussing sustainability and business relationships. Thank you.